Who am I? I was appointed professor at the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna in 2003, teaching for the studio for conceptual art. But also I'm a case of transdisciplinary professor, that means I'm a doctor of philosophy, so I also monitor quite some of the future doctorants or doctors in philosophy. The Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna is a polystructured institution that connects many fields, not only art, but also forming the professors who will teach art in other schools, offering doctorate in philosophy and philosophy of art, and also doctorates in art, architecture, scenography. So it's actually a very important institution because of this polyvalent structure. When I started to teach in 2003, I decided to change conceptually the name, only conceptually, in Studio for Post-Conceptual Art Practices, because conceptual art was something of the history, and I wanted actually to face the 2000 and what will come on. When I started to teach and I took this position, for me this was a political decision. I think it's challenging actually to enter such an institution, but also it means that we cannot come out as innocent body and claim any innocence in the process of production of knowledge and being part of the institution of art. Now, when is the time that I'm talking for the camera? This is the 17th of November 2020, and this time is specific because it's under the sign of COVID-19. And the COVID-19, the coronavirus, affected terminally the educational system. Universities in 2020 are closed for the second time, but also other schools are closed, mostly in many parts of the European Union. All is going on virtually and digitally. This has an effect on the whole system of knowledge and on the institution of art, but also on the society. Many are stuck in the limbo. Why I'm saying this? Because we have to ask ourselves, who are those who are without a computer and the internet and have no space to work? Many, too many. Do they have food to eat properly? This is not a stupid moral question, because actually all these questions are connected with the institution of art being central to the system of reproduction. Knowledge is material and not spiritual. Your intestines works in order for us to think. So who are those who have nothing to eat? The number is even bigger. Practically 50% of the students in the academy is precarious workers. But this number goes until 90%. Though the most aggravated positions are those of the so-called third state countries. These are students that are not part of the European Union. Their lives is heavy. They have to have money on a bank account for getting a visa. They are part of the administration of the state, and this administration, it's like a rope around their neck. It's a grip, a clinch. So it seems we talk so much about the autonomous position of the institution of art, the academies and so on, but more and more is becoming clear that the neoliberal global capitalist states in the European Union, the police and state administration, are those who decide who can study, because they give the visas, they give the permits, and so on. So the first question that is being key for the reformation of the academies, art, university, is the question of autonomy. Paradoxically, it's coming before what is called knowledge production. And this autonomy is so important that in the Occident we see big changes in the last period. So, on November 13, 2020, directors of several institutions of art in Austria, also from the Academy of Fine Arts Vienna, wrote a letter to the Federal Ministry of Education, Science and Research, because rumors are all around that the new amendments of the university law in Austria will take under huge control the Senate of universities and academies is the most important parliamentary body. The power will be given instead to the Senate, to rectorate, but even more to some university councils. The university councils are actually political bodies. Representatives of the political parties in power are inside, and this means the autonomy of the institution of art, something that was the sign of the open society in the West, is under big suppression. But these are only some of the changes in this letter. Others are connected with the speed-up study that is now or will be imposed on the students. To finish as soon as possible, to start to work, but where? And also to pay tax. So all this is going on in the time of the corona situation, and this prevents a big exchange of opinions, a public discussion, and so on. So we see how the corona is actually working with restructuring of the place of the institution of art and academies. What is with this virus? Daniela Meyer, an anthropologist that worked intensively with us in the past, wrote me a mail and stated, "A virus, it's a very neoliberal one, free circulation of goods and money, but a total restriction of human movement. The transfer of tax money towards enterprises and companies, isolation of people at home, and so on." This was in March 2020. And then the Academy decided to open a special project program to get some points for those who will be active, helping in the time of coronavirus, engaging on social platforms, helping the community, helping the neighbor. A very good move. Another student, Henry Denise, wrote a small report. She stated, 2020, the summer semester, was the stolen year. The whole world has come to a standstill, and the reason is the pandemic COVID-19. All of a sudden, it seems like humanity, touching, hugging, talking, kindness, parting, all the good stuff affiliated with socializing has come to an end. And every form of discrimination became the order of the day. She said, "I have to take care of the community of the Afro Rainbow Austria that she is chairing." And also, for her it's important to draw and help the community. Consequences of the pandemic on our very vulnerable community are, she states, job loss, depression, homelessness, and the standstill of asylum procedures, to name some. Therefore, we see that all what was said until now is actually interventions on the institution of art, and also have big consequences for what is called production, distribution, and institutionalization of knowledge. It seems that it's a task today by neoliberal global capitalism to change and transform universities and academies into managerial institutions that will produce skilled students. The final point of this is to practically make a pressure on the public institution to change the public institution and also to make them kind of an apolitical institutions for just technological skill and agency. Also, the demand is to just finish as soon as possible the study and in a certain way to suppress the autonomy. Already more than 10 years ago, a scholar, Kirsten Folkert, when it was very actual to talk about the Bologna program, wrote the following. She made remarks on the contradictions of post-studio practices concerning the academy in the present political climate. We of course invited Kirsten Folkert to come to Vienna from Canada because we named ourselves post-conceptual art practices, and she was writing about post-studio practices. She said, "The changes that are taking part have to do a lot with art commodity value, as well as with the role of the artist concerning another figure, the white collar. This is a kind of a professional, and artist, this is the idea, should be something very similar. But they are both symptom and response to certain political and economic shifts." What this means? At that point, we didn't know, but it came very clear. Financialization, administrative taking off the autonomy, skills and productivity. So, what we do? What is our plan? The Post-Conceptual Art Practices Department actually is a studio, works with a contextualization of art, and this contextualization cannot go differently than with theory and reflection. How actually theory and critical practice contaminate art practices with the social and vice versa. And again, I have to quote Kirsten Folkert, because she was the one who were envisioning the changes that we are facing today. I quote, "Post-studio practices challenge the assumption that art is about technical virtuosity or mute creative expression, and that what happens in the studio or classroom is separate from the rest of our lives. Certain aspects of post-studio practice also question the artist's definition as romantic, heroic individual, also imagined as white and male, one who does not consider the political or economic context of his work. On the other hand, how much do post-studio practices, as they are taught within the academy, really challenge conventional definitions of authorship or signature style?" So, what could be some points for the future that we apply and work on in the present? Activism, politics, and theory are the most important for practices and politics of representation. Theory is not an old academic theory that suffocates the art practice, but a contemporary theoretical and critical thinking that helps students to develop processes for conceptualization of fine arts and the politics of the world in many different layers. Also, the idea is to keep the bridge between media and technology, but not only film, photo, video, but also social platforms, in order to develop politically and socially engaged art that can intervene in a wider context. Art is not a tool that can be simply applied for a certain innocent process of production and distribution of images and knowledge. Education is not a transparent machine for production and circulation of skills. So, we are aware of this. We also published some books as a process of communal work that is one of the most important points. The first book we published in 2005-06, it was on anti-Semitism. The second was on feminism. The third, that came out in 2013, has a subtitle, The Vocabulary of Decoloniality, and it puts at its central point social and political antagonism, what this means, how we form our epistemologies to take into account past colonialism and present forms of coloniality, and to focus on anti-racism, a new political figure, the migrant. Nobody talks about the migrants in these days. But also to, in a certain way, reflect on the invigorated anti-Semitism and see how all these processes of racialization and rationalization affect knowledge. So, to summarize, one, what is necessary to be done? Definitely is to rethink Western democracy and imperialism, colonialism in relation to the knowledge that we produce. The outcome of this is a program of anti-racist policy, questioning the regime of supremacist whiteness or the regime of whiteness as such, as regime of power that has only one line of time. But time is not white. Time is colorful. Then is, of course, the consequent criticism of rising anti-Semitism and other forms of racism, but also thinking about fascism and the role of art in all this. Art lost its central potential as it was in the 70s. Today, science, biotechnology, computers are those who redirect, or as Louis Artiservi say, over determine what matters in the society. Still, art has a power, cannot be just an anthropological machine, something only about affect, but can use its potential for critical discourses, reformulating memories and histories, open a space for activist engagement, and formats of art that we cannot name now as art. But soon, maybe this will be the space where we will have a chance to do this. That means also developing artistic practices with trans, feminist and migrant queer positions. So again, not one line of knowledge, but actually a pluriversal horizon of knowledge that will also embrace other formats of practices and also other formats of knowledges. Final projects as research that will work on community-based works and also on intensive exchange with other communities outside of the institution of art.